take into consideration as much public input as possible. What we have found, both from prior workshops on this issue as well as a first of two scheduled public hearings, is that most of the input and concerns of the citizens fall basically into six areas. Agricultural issues, forestry and timber management issues, both large scale developing areas of land as well as small scale landowners, individual lots. The fourth major area has been concern about buffers. Are they too restrictive? Are they not restrictive enough in the proposed ordinance? The fifth major area of input has focused upon simply the definitions that we have used in this ordinance and how the definitions have differed from federal and state definitions of wetlands themselves, as well as other definitions in the ordinance that we've tried to define very clearly, or at least as clearly as possible, at the very onset of the document, so that everyone is talking basically about the same thing. And then lastly, the sixth area, and perhaps one of the most complicated areas to the wetland plan, involves the current wetlands map that is to my left, and I hope the viewers can see it as well as they can. And if you need to put a close-up on that, that'd be perfectly fine. So what we have been recently doing has been to address the major areas involving forest management activities, timber harvesting, and agriculture, trying to deal with the first two of the six, at least, major areas of public input. And to that effect, draft number 21 has basically included definitions of forest management activities, definitions of timber harvesting. We've specifically spoken about agriculture. We have modified section 18.4-8 in section 2 with reference to tree cutting, as this area is currently being proposed to be eliminated as a consequence of adding two entirely new sections, section 18.4-9 involving timber harvesting and 18.4-10 with respect to agriculture itself. So those really are capsulized the specific changes and alterations that we have attempted to fine-tune the ordinance about since the prior draft number 20. So this, I guess the date on this particular one should be pretty much right up to the moment. Well, January 19th, 1990. That being said, I'm entirely open as to where this workshop would like to move. We can deal with any one of the six areas of concern. We can deal with the specific changes that have taken place since draft 20 to draft 21. I should note that unfortunately we just all received today three new pieces of information. Thomas Riddell from the Seaward Nurseries has forwarded us information and opinions and input about the ordinance. Another Sprague Corporation letter has come in dated January 29th to the town planner, and I have just at this moment in time put my eyes upon this document, and I can see that my past success with Evelyn Wood is not going to help me here today, as these are very specific suggestions here on very specific technical issues involving at least 10 or 12 sections of the ordinance. So I thank you very much for this input, but obviously we are not going to be able to deal with this in this workshop, since we all need to digest that with some time. And there was a third document somewhere that, oh, I guess Gary Cummings also sent in a letter dated January 27th, which is the third of probably about 10, maybe 12 pieces of material that have come in specifically from individuals offering suggestions about additions, deletions, and that type of thing. But, you know, that being said, I think one of the purposes this afternoon for having this workshop was to basically brainstorm together where we are moving with this ordinance and trying to coordinate the Conservation Commission, the Planning Board, the Ordinance Committee, the Town Council as a whole, so that everyone is basically updated outside of a public hearing, given that we're going to be having tentatively the second public hearing on this issue at our March 1990 Town Council General Meeting. So I guess need to take some direction, perhaps, Mr. Chairman, from yourself or anyone else as to where the most fruitful direction would be for this afternoon.
Well, I think the proper way to go now is, anybody got a question to any one of the three experts that we have with us that we can, yes, Councilor?
I wanted to just ask you to summarize again, if you would, Wayne, the six areas that you saw, that you listed there, because I had done my own list of the areas, and I think I might be able to add one.
Sure.
I've got the agriculture, forestry, and timber. You put that together?
Yes.
Okay, then developer, homeowner?
Yeah.
Okay, that my only other one was the grandfathering issue, which I guess would come in under that, developer, homeowner, because there seemed to be constant questions about what was grandfathered, what should be, and what happens to a person that bought a lot of land pre-1984. So we could lump that under that, I guess.
Yes, I mean, the grandfathering issue, I mean, is going to apply, obviously, to proposed developments. It's going to apply to individual lot owners, and at what point in time is this document going to go back to as a point in time. And also, I think there was genuine concern at the first public hearing with respect to the whole issue of agricultural purposes being grandfathered at all. Just as a philosophy in the town as to whether that is an appropriate or an inappropriate philosophy. So the grandfathering issues really weave, you know, throughout the entire ordinance as I see it.
Okay. Anybody else?
Could we talk about the wetlands map?
Talk about anything you wish. What would you like to know?
Well, we've had a lot of complaints at the public hearing and in the letter. That the map is inaccurate. I know that the Conservation Commission, I believe, did the mapping, and I know you worked very hard on it, and I also know that maps tend to be inaccurate, even if they are done by professionals, by the state, for example. We found that soil maps are inaccurate, etc. It seems to me the track that we've taken in this ordinance is to rely upon that map as an indication of the critical wetlands and the protection zones as mapped. Another alternative would be to ad hoc on every development, that is to have a professional come in and tell us whether or not wetlands are involved. A third way, it seems to me, is to rely upon the map to some extent, figuring that it's suggested and that it's up to the developer to rebut any indication that a development would be in the wetlands. It seems to me we've got to bite the bullet and do that, because if we rely excessively on that map, we're going to be in trouble.
I agree with
the trouble.
Yeah, deep trouble. I agree with you 100%. Anybody want to comment on that?
I can clarify a few things, Nancy. That map is a modification of the map that we now have of the Cape Elizabeth wetlands, and it was derived in two ways. We were sensitive to the fact that you can't define wetlands by vegetation alone, nor can you define them by soil type alone. So the present map and the one that's proposed here are a combination of those two features. The difference between the one we have now and the old one is that we now have some new soil types that have been added because we found in the past that our soil type definitions were not accurate. Now, the soil type part of that map is in fact based primarily on the Hometown Soil Survey Mean Intensity Survey, which is in fact pretty good, but not all that accurate. Mm-hmm. You certainly can't draw a line on the ground and say this is wetland, this isn't, but you can define where wetland soils are. The other aspect of it was a vegetative criteria that was in fact done by several individuals actually going over the people in the field and seeing where there were wetland plants, primarily where they were captive. This was done in 1975.
Was that a summer intern?
That was three people, actually.
Who were they?
They were myself. They were another member of my family. They were Lisa Clifford, who did most of it. Lisa's now working with Robert Gerber as a hydrogeologist.
Mm-hmm. You were working with him?
No, not at that point. Lisa Clifford is now working with him. Lisa was the person who did most of our on-the-ground survey of wetland plants. It's by no means a professional type of a survey that would be done on a single lot today by Norman, for example. And here is where the cat is at, type of thing, so that we could come up with, so we could A, see how that correlated with our soils type, which we find to be naturally quite well. But just to have a general idea of where wetlands were. The old map and the new one, in fact, is not supposed to draw a line on the surface of the earth and say this is a wetland and this isn't. In the ordinance, there is language that says it's subject to field verification for that very purpose. So your last suggestion that you had that the wetland map be used as a suggestion to the area of where wetlands are, subject to verification, is exactly where we are.
Well,
do
we need language that makes it quite clear that the map is not the final word?
I think you have it in the ordinance now.
Well, I know we have verification, site verification, but can we use the word suggestive or some word that raises a flag that this is not the end all and be all? Because there seems to be considerable concern about that.
Steve, you got a comment on
it? A comment. I think one area the subject to field verification is no longer in the ordinance. I'm not sure what it dropped out, but if the wetland, that's on page 4. I just want to clarify that. That may be something we'll get added in.
Why is it out?
Don't you really worry if we lost it on the road?
Well, Mr. Allen, definitely should be. It was, I remember,
17, 18. Somewhere, perhaps 17, 19 probably was starting that. I think the one thing that, with respect to that, and you know, the map, is that for a development, for a subdivision or a site plan, if there are any wetlands or apparently on the site, the planning board would require an applicant to do a high-intensity soil survey or even perhaps a separate wetlands analysis to accurately show the boundaries. I think where the map's purpose comes in primarily is to assist town staff, building inspector, co-enforcement officer, in seeing if there's any possibility of wetlands impacts for somebody who wants to take out a building permit for one lot, or somebody who normally wouldn't be expected to do high-intensity soil survey, would be expected to do a wetlands analysis. And in that case, I think the map serves an important function to at least flag the possibility of big wetlands conditions. I think in the ordinance, though, there's language in here that allows the building inspector to go out and with advice from the town planner and the conservation commission, everybody goes out there and sees that it's high and dry, and there's just no way it could possibly be a wetland. In that case, at that point, the building inspector would have the ability then to then state that the going through the wetlands alteration process would no longer be necessary. So I think there are measures in here to help prevent some of the worst-case scenarios that people would think of when they read some of the language.
We definitely, Steve, put the site verification back in. I really had three lots, and I think it still is. And then when we look at page one, the areas where these regulations apply. A, critical wetland zone, areas so designated on the Cape Elizabeth wetlands map and other areas defined herein as critical wetland zones as well as applicable wetland buffers. But that areas so designated, that sounds to me as if that is the final word. Can we use something like suggested or?
I think if you wish, we could change it so that information would be there.
It definitely implies that this is it.
Well, can we add subject to field verification right there? I mean, how much does that change the?
And do you want to say field verification by the applicant?
Again, I think now we're getting into, you know, who's paying the money, and it's a very expensive proposition, I think, that we've all struggled with as one of the more painful elements of the ordinance, that all of this, regardless of who is doing it, is a very expensive proposition from, you know, one lot to many lots, and I think that's something that we've got to keep in mind.
But if an area, in a single house, for example, a single lot. If an area is flagged by map, and the building inspector goes out, and the planner, and somebody from the conservation commission, and they look at it, and it's quite obvious that a wetland is not involved. There's no need for any further site verification. It's only when there's when the owner says, no way is this a weapon, that somebody has to bear the burden of proving that it is or it isn't.
My understanding of the ordinance was that if there was any question at all, the town code enforcement officer would go out. And if looking at things, he thinks that there is a wetland, with perhaps a conservation commission or the planning board member there, and they both feel by looking that it is, then the burden of proof to prove that it is or isn't is on the person who wants to construct something in that area. But that initially the town goes out without any paid experts at that point and does a field survey by just looking at the area. So they don't. Anyone who wants to develop in this wetland area does not have the initial expense of bringing in experts immediately, just automatically. Wasn't that the intent?
Just when there's a question.
Right.
The concern I've heard from people is, you go out and you do that, and you have people from town boards go out. Are they going to do a test? Are they going to dig and see what the soil is? And what? How accurately can they tell, depending on the time of year, what the vegetation is? And that's how we're defining our wetlands. And then if you get back and the code enforcement officer's determination is, yes, it is, say, a wetland protection zone, the only way to appeal that appears to be going through all the hoops of basically a site plan review before the planning board.
And if it's winter, it's very difficult to get the plans that you need.
It's not impossible, but it's probably expensive for the town, who is not at that point hiring experts say, yes, this is a wetland based on soil and/or vegetation. And I think, you know, I want to put, you know, new family room on the house, I'm going to go through that many codes just because on the map it shows that I might be in a wetland protection zone. I want to also address the point that Peter made about the accuracy of the Cumberland County Soil Survey. I was dying for someone at the last public hearing to tell me how accurate that was. Steve, how accurate is it? Do you know? What figure accuracy do you use for that?
I think it's, I'm not sure. It's, you know, half acre, quarter acre. I mean, it's not very accurate. But what we found is, for the past few years, we've used a different wetlands map, also based on the Cumberland County Soil Survey. And when Peter Rand and I looked at it, that map's been relatively accurate. I mean, the boundaries aren't exact, but more often than not, if there's a, you know, if it's marked as a wetlands on that map, you're probably in a wetland, you're pretty close. When, having worked with the planning board for a while, when Peter Rand and I went through this and checked it, you know, tried to do some checks from our knowledge of the town, we found that, to our surprise somewhat, that the information there was relatively accurate. Again, you're not going to get down to, you know, 3 or 5 foot sort of accuracy, but in terms of maps, especially in orange, the critical wetland zones are mapped on there, but for the most part, the, you know, the boundaries are fairly accurate, which was surprising given the fact that you're dealing with medium intensity soils.
Anybody else?
I think one thing we also could keep in mind is that there's a new state legislation that requires an applicant bringing forth a subdivision submission to map the wetlands on the subdivision. Have you seen that?
Well, that's out of the law on the subdivision as well as a couple other sections. Mm-hmm. The question always is, how do you define wetlands?
I also had a chance last evening at this circumstance to talk with Lisa Clifford Robinson. We were talking about the wetlands map, and she again reiterated the fact that you need to do field verification. She very strongly stated that last night.
That actually becomes a process in this development. Everything will eventually be verified. It's going to be verified according to the criteria for wetlands definition in the ordinance, whether they're very poorly drained hybrid mineral or very poorly drained organic soils, or whether they have organic wetland plants, which are quite definitive definitions of wetlands. You can take soils, say, and either it is or it isn't, very poorly drained hybrid soils listed in the list of the ordinance, or plants that are on there are obligate or aren't obligate. So there are some, when you really bring down the water as a wetland or not, you have those definitions to go by. One wonders if a lot of time could not be saved by, in fact, having a wetland evaluator or some wetland evaluating resource that would, the questions of whether the definition came up, could be called to look at the property. Would then say, yes, that does fit the criteria, or it doesn't. And then we get out of this whole business of having a developer get a wetland evaluated, and the town get a wetland evaluated, a great loss of great excess effort. The developer's wetland expert may say, I only define wetlands by vegetative criteria. And so a lot of time with flagging the woods for that criteria, and then the town will come up with, no, we use something else. And then somebody will say, well, no, we use the DEP, we have a lot of different definitions, and the way that you spend a lot of time and a lot of effort and get a lot of frustration is to have people coming and representing all those different definitions. It seems if we had, in fact, a town definition, that was it, and we had an evaluator that would say the land either fit that definition or didn't, you know, get rid of all the rest of the town.
So Peter, we have town expert.
Who would pay for the evaluator? Is that the question?
I would say this is a town expert. Somebody on a consultant basis. Out of town's market.
Just a conservationist, I don't know what politicians were. worked out that way.
It ends your way to get out of it, Peter.
It's an interesting philosophical question, though. Does the entire town bear the burden of having a person who's thinking about making an investment? There's a number of criteria that you tick off when you're going to make an investment, and anybody that's buying land or a house in Cape Elizabeth, there isn't a person on earth that isn't thinking of it in terms of an investment, and it may be one other additional expense that you have to tick off in terms of making sure that this is where you want to build, this is what you want to buy. I wonder if all the citizens should bear the burden of that.
You're suggesting, Peter, almost to put the thing out to arbitration, I mean, to a certain extent, I mean, and but agree ahead of time that the decision of the arbitrator or the expert is going to be final, so that the adversarial sort of, you know, town versus citizen who wants to build is eliminated.
That's right.
But you would have to have, I would think, some sort of an appeals process.
There is one listed in here.
Well, I'm talking about this town evaluator concept. You would really have to have an appeals process, which would get you all bound up in disagreeing experts.
The problem, as Peter has stated, is the fact that we have people going out declaring whether or not something is a wetland, and all using different definitions. If we have the town definition, they all have to answer, make their judgment based on our definition and not the DEPs or the federal, whichever one they find suits their purpose better. And
I
whether or not,
that
well, that the it's just like any other kind of standards that we have in town. We basically have things listed or a direct reference to something. If we have our own definition, that is the only way something can be judged.
Yeah, but why should the town put a line on my property or somebody else's property and say it wetland and make me prove to you that it isn't a wetland? If you're going to put a line on my property, you should put the line where the wetland is and not where it's high and dry. That's my point.
You're going back to the map.
That's right.
Which should be a guide and not the absolute positive criteria. Right.
But
and it should be done to scale. All the overlays should be to scale.
What scale?
Well, we have cattails there that are about an acre big on the overlay. That's what I'm saying. If you're going to show vegetative growth, it maybe should be more to scale with the basic map itself. We should be willing to pay money to have a more definitive map made. But it is basically a guide. It gives the administrator, it gives the developer, it gives everyone an idea that you're getting into maybe a critical wetland area, and then you have to kick in the expert and some of the field
survey.
That's
a part of public expenditure that I would support, is spending more money to get a more accurate map, and then having this idea that this is the we've gotten it as close as we can within the ball game of not fine-tuning it down to yards, which we couldn't do, but we'll really know what areas we feel are potential wetlands, and then from there it's up to them to fine-tune it. I would go along with that.
Are we talking about a medium intensity or a, what's the high intensity? I'm just wondering if even a professional expert made a map, how much more accurate it would be.
To do a high intensity of the entire town, it would be astronomical. And there's some people here who could talk about what they paid for their sites, and probably would realize some cost savings, but still, it would be a phenomenal.
And medium intensity would probably not be much more accurate than what we've got. Is that?
But you could have somebody perhaps put the line, better do some field checks in terms of the map, open up to the public to see, you know, if anybody has a complaint about the lines in the map, give them an opportunity to register them with the town so somebody knows exactly where some of the problem areas are. I mean, so there may be an intermediate step that could be done to try and tie down the map somewhat.
Yes, go ahead.
To go back to who pays, I'm so always so interested in who pays.
So nice.
On page 7 of this particular draft, item 3, under special permit procedure, it seems that the ordinance has addressed who's going to pay if an applicant has to go to the planning board. and indicates that if there's a, so couldn't part of this be taken out of here and used as a guide concerning individual cases that don't go before the planning board? But I guess they wouldn't have an escrow account.
There is a section in the ordinance that says that the co-enforcement officer or the board or whomever, various boards can use an expert, can hire an expert. And that, again, it's implied at least that that's something to be done by town. Using town funds, it could be done at the period before you get before the planning board. So it's in there. You may want to amplify that. You may want to discuss it to see whether or not you agree with that.
This could be a very expensive ordinance to enforce.
I call it my neighbor's ordinance. My neighbor don't like what I'm doing, they go to the ordinance and find out. Otherwise, it sits on the shelf.
I don't know how you would find out what was going on every possible thing, that wasn't coming before the planning board, subdivision, and building.
Although the wetlands, I guess, are an evolutionary thing that changed. They're not always going to stay the same, but at some point, as you get more and more of these things logged in, then you're going to have more and more of the town on record, and eventually you have the whole town on record. It may be a time-consuming process, but eventually you're going to get there. I mean, I think it takes longer time than just years for the wetlands to change around here. But
anybody,
a while we can get
anybody else on that? You got something new?
I have.
Yeah, go ahead. Mary.
Just something else. On that new section, Steve, on the timber harvesting,
yes.
I didn't quite understand some of it. Why, in the definition on page 2, 50 cords, you know, being a homeowner who has ordered one cord, why was 50 cords used as a guide, and how many average-sized trees would that constitute? And I'm just thinking of someone like a farmer who might want to cut down his own trees or sell a few trees. I mean, how many trees would that
I'll answer the first question first. The second one, I asked somebody who's a little more knowledgeable about forestry than I am, sitting in the audience, to kind of come up with a kind of our acreage range, and it depends upon, you know, the density, the number of trees in an area. What the count, but getting back to the more general issue, is that the town council was trying to differentiate between true commercial-like timber harvesting compared to something less. And they're trying to come up with, and they finally asked me to see if I could come up with some sort of differentiation so that at some point the code enforcement officer could say, this is timber harvesting. And we were looking at the monetary value, which is difficult. We're looking at, well, if it's for sale, is that an issue? But then if somebody wants to cut down, we'll cut a cord of timber and sell it to his or her neighbor, that didn't seem to quite, you know, fall into what people thought timber harvesting was. So what I did was met with John Green from the Spray Corporation, and we went through a number of items in timber harvesting, and we looked at some information that he had and I had, and came up with 50 cords of timber as being some way of drawing the line. It's not pretty clear.
Between little business and big business.
Right. So that somebody, I mean, up to 50 cords, which is a fair amount of wood, that below that it wouldn't fall under kind of the heavier standards of timber harvesting. Now, if you want, John perhaps could talk about the range in terms of the number of acres that might, you know, take up.
How many trees is a cord?
Well, it depends how big the tree is.
Well, let's say...
How many size of the tree you get?
Let's say six inches. Would that be...
How tall is
one
it?
One tree? Oh, you know, a tall tree.
Okay.
It's tough.
What?
30 possible.
30 trees?
Well, one tree could conceivably have as many as 10 cords, seeing that possible.
Say something that was 6 inch.
I'm just guessing, I'm going to say 30, 40 trees.
30 is one tree.
Oh, that isn't a very big tree. That's a small one. They wouldn't hardly cut that one.
4x4x8 is what we're talking about.
That's
128 cubic feet.
It's just a rough figure.
Yeah, he's saying for one cord.
4x4x8 is a cord.
Right.
So it's 128 cubic feet of wood.
Yeah.
you need for a cord.
This is very limb.
Right?
That's right.
That's a limb.
Okay. Anybody else?
Can I go back?
Yes.
I wanted to go back to the definition one more time as we were kind of wrapping that thing up. One of the things that's been assailed most loudly has been our definition. And time and again, people have come at us that our definition is wrong, it's inappropriate, it's exaggerated. And quoting from one of the letters here from Larry Clough, in respect to soil type mentioned definition, hydric soils, I think the town would be better served by vegetative soil type definition. That's the most substantive critique that I've heard of it. What's right about our definition? What's so controversial about it? Why are we going more than the state and the feds necessitate, and why is that good? In other words, I'd just like to hear one of the key elements for me is...
The way I understand it is, as it stands now, the town defines wetlands by either vegetative type or by soil. Mm-hmm. You have one or the other, it's a wetland. What the state's kind of in a state of flux. The Army Corps, the same definition, Army Corps, now the state thing, but is that you need to have two or three variables. You need to have soil and vegetation and or hydrology. Usually hydrology is there if you have the other two. But whereas the town now, as well as with this ordinance, in most cases would use this one criteria, which in some cases would expand the boundary a little bit. We drew the lines purely on a soils basis, and then purely on vegetation, you could have some traces of vegetation, for instance, that could go beyond what, you know, a lot of people might consider the densely vegetated wetland area. So I think some of the problem or some of the concern is that the town may be going a little bit beyond what the federal government would require. Because you're just dealing with one, the evidence of one factor. I think some of the comments perhaps exaggerate the concern of one cattail sticking up isolated. Does that make the weapon? I don't know.
So right now we're going with strictly vegetative, is that what you're saying?
No, we're doing both. We're using both, but not in combination. What I'm saying is the Army Corps would need to have both together. We need to have vegetation of a certain amount and soil of a certain amount, hydrology kind of thrown in there. Then that would be a wetland. If you had an area that just had some wet soil but there's no vegetation, the Army Corps wouldn't call that a wetland. It would include that in the boundary. The town of Cape Elizabeth most likely would.
Do you have any idea roughly in terms of acreage, if it was both criteria had to be applied, how much less acreage there'd be that would be defined as wetlands? Any ballpark? Or?
I would think it wouldn't be that much less. I mean, I think that most cases you're going to find going to be about the same, except for the little, I mean, it depends upon how strict the town gets. I mean, if the town wanted to really be ridiculous, I suppose, you'd say two clumps of sensitive fern out in the middle of a high and dry field would be a wetland. I don't think the town would do that.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think the variation is going to be all that different, but I don't know. And then people who obviously think that there's going to be a drastic change.
Yeah, but if you do it with vegetation, you can rearrange an area within a few years, and then you've got some of those plants and what have you growing there, and that creates a wetland.
Right.
And it might not be a wetland as far as the soils go, but if you rearrange it and pack it enough and block off the water drainage, you can make a wetland very easy in a fairly high place.
In short term, the vegetation will come first, but after a certain amount of years, the soils will start to change their characteristics.
Some That's right, and it's happened in a couple of places in Cape Elizabeth already. Go ahead.
I'd just like to get sort of maybe a consensus, if at all a consensus is possible, with respect to the land that we're talking about. Because, the purpose of the whole ordinance is to protect the wetlands. I mean, I think we all sort of agree on that. But we're talking about specific areas of land in Cape Elizabeth that are, depending on whose definition we're going to use, wetlands. And then we're talking about specific areas that surround those areas as critical wetland zones. And then we're talking about areas that surround those two areas being the buffers. And, you know, one of the great outcry, I mean, if there's any sort of funneling down of citizen complaint, is that we've gone too far. I mean, we're trying to include too much land that the more, you know, concentric circles you put around this valuable piece of land, obviously the more people you're going to involve and the more difficulties, I mean, you're going to run into. And I just, you know, I wonder about, again, I would throw out a couple, two things. I would throw out one, Steve's suggestion in his last letter to the ordinance committee of one, should we reduce or eliminate the wetland buffers for all uses, period. Just eliminate the buffers entirely and be dealing with two specific areas that are valuable areas that we don't want to see altered. And the second point I'll throw out is, ought we to perhaps use the system that the state is proposing in their December 12, 1989 draft of the wetlands protection, in that we would have either class one, class two, or class three wetlands and eliminate critical wetland zones entirely to simplify the issue. I throw both of those issues out only to suggest that we could potentially involve less land and still protect what we want to protect.
I think it's a good point. Yes, Mary.
Good to me. I think any simplification of this would be in order. It is a very complicated, and if we could do class one, class two, and class three, and achieve the same thing, I would be delighted with it. And on buffers, though, isn't the state going to mandate a 250-foot buffer zone, Steve?
Okay, go ahead.
The two issues kind of are somewhat related. One thing I didn't mention in the introduction, which I should have, is that all along, what I and other folks that have worked on this have been using as a guide is the stale draft municipal shoreline zoning ordinance that's been under development for about 2.5 years at least up to DEP. And that's look, and within that, I think all of you received in your last package, it's going to be these standards, whatever shape or form they kind of come out in, that the town of Cape Elizabeth is going to have to adhere to. Not the other DEP wetlands regulation standards, which deal with, that's where you're getting the class one, class two, class three wetlands. Unless things change, the shoreland zoning is going to be different from that. That's the one issue. But under shoreland zoning, at least how it looks now, at least for some wetlands, the DEP is still recommending a 250-foot buffer, which probably is going to continue unless the politics change. So if you don't do the buffers now, that's fine, but you may have to in the next year and a half. I just heard recently from a DEP staff person that communities aren't going to have to, probably aren't going to have to upgrade their shoreline zoning ordinance until a year from this coming July, which I'll let you know for when we talk about that with the planning board, you'll know why we aren't doing much work on it. But the other issue is that in terms of the buffers, you have some time latitude in terms of when you have to put those on. But sooner or later.
What do they have to be around?
They have to be around wetlands.
I mean, according to the definition of draft 21 that we have in front of us.
In terms of this here.
No, that as it meshes in with this. The
right.
Present language.
Right now, I have to be around all critical wetlands. Mm-hmm. Except, and it's 250 feet unless certain physical situations are slope, or if you're near in a built up area, then the 250 foot buffer gets reduced to 100 feet. The state at a minimum is going to require wetlands. Is that clear?
Mm-hmm.
The state at a minimum is going to require, it appears, they're going to require buffers around wetlands with moderate or high wildlife habitat value. There's probably 6 or 7. I have a map here that kind of indicates them. Some of the obvious ones are going to be Great Pond, Spurwick Marsh, wetlands like that. They're probably going to have a buffer sooner or later anyway. There are other, a few others that are smaller. So.
But Steve, you do keep making the point that, I mean, on both these documents that we've poured over, I mean, both the shoreland zoning as well as the proposed wetlands regulations state document, I mean, these still are all in draft form. And I don't know, Nancy tells us from her experience with the board that, you know, that there's a big gap oftentimes between what, you know, actually is in draft form and what comes out as state law. And I mean, again, I'm just throwing out, are we trying to sort of head off at the pass, so to speak, law that's going to be coming down the road so we then don't have to go through this ordinance and redo it again? But do we have any clear guarantees that these drafts are pretty close to enactment?
No guarantees. This is the third or fourth draft, so as much as you can pin the folks down up there that are working on shoreline zoning, I've been hearing that the buffers are going to stay.
I mean, I think the bottom line is I think we're trying very hard to anticipate state law that is causing us to get completely backlogged with regard to moving forward in a healthier fashion on this issue.
And that's why I think one of the recommendations that I tried to list out was one, just if you wanted to, the easy route perhaps would be just to either reduce or eliminate the buffer, and you postpone that at least for the short term. And if the DEP decides to change that requirement and eliminate it, then you never have to revisit it. If they do, it'll be put in the closet, but just for a little while.
I'd love to hear then from your expert point of view or others that are expert in the field, because the second most berated point other than definition has been the buffer. There's got to be strong ecological reasons why, if you have a critical wetland, it makes sense from an ecological point of view to have a buffer area around it. What is the reasoning that those that are in this field and are arguing this case make?
There's several. I think the two come down to, especially in terms of 250 feet, which is a large distance, that is primarily to preserve the wildlife habitat, that a lot of birds, animals, and all the like don't necessarily use the wetland itself. They use the edge of the wetland, that critical edge, so to speak. The other factor, I think, is in terms of having some buffer, is to create, in essence, what just that buffer between some land use, if it's residential, you know, the fertilizer, want to keep some sort of natural vegetative buffer that kind of helps to kind of strain out certain things that might adversely affect the wetland.
Like possible polluting or possible things that could happen from having a house there and the natural things to go with that type of a use,
right,
being that close or juxtaposed right up next to a critical wetland.
And that's why the DEP and the permit by rule, which is a situation where they kind of almost, you know, in a way negotiate for the developer in terms of what has to be done. They, in fact, even there, I just looked at it recently, they have a formula that says that you have to have at least 45 feet, I believe it is, and then if, depending on the slope, they add more and more feet onto it, and if you have a very steep slope, they can require permit by rule up to 100 feet in terms of buffer. So, I mean, I think they're saying that even for lesser wetlands, if there are such a thing, there needs, you know, perhaps needs to be some sort of buffer. The 250-foot buffer, I think, is for primarily for the wildlife habitat.
I just want to say that I think there's benefit to having a buffer. And in some of the discussions we've had over the last few months, it's been almost assumed that this is like a frivolous or superfluous thing that we're adding on for no reason. Any more than we're anxious to protect the wetlands, this is part of that process. And I think there's people in Cape Elizabeth that understand that and know that. But yet at some of the public hearings, it's been almost like a buffer is a negotiating chip that we can use, or it's an unnecessary thing. I guess I just don't see it that way. I see it as part of this overall plan. So
I don't think they all feel that it's unnecessary. I think they feel there should be a buffer, but it doesn't have to be a blanket 250 feet.
Isn't there some that's 100 too, though? It's 250
or
100? Yeah,
but it's certain conditions, yeah. Mary, I think Angie, no, yes?
Well, I kind of forgot what I was going to say.
Well.
But there is under standards, when the planning board is granting a special permit, on page 10, under one of the things mentioned said, will maintain an adequate buffer area between the wetland and adjacent land uses. What is an adequate buffer area between the wetland and adjacent land uses? That sounds very objected to me. We just heard 50 feet, 100 feet, 250 feet. If a person comes before the planning board, and is looking for a special permit, how can we determine what this adequate buffer would be? Who will?
I think you'd be looking, the planning board would be looking at the evidence that was presented by the applicant using the information it had. I think in many cases that if you were dealing with the existing buffer area, that you would probably be just talking about whether or not that buffer should be increased or, in some cases, I suppose, decreased. But, you know, for instance, in an area, if you had a built-up area where the ordinance said the buffer, instead of being 250 feet, was reduced down to 100, but everybody knew, and there's evidence that deer graded through there, you know, this whole area, that it was important perhaps to, as to preserve this wildlife travel corridor, to have more than 100 feet that was part of the ordinance. You might be able to use that as kind of as a way to determine whether or not the adequate buffer is being provided or not, or whether or not the applicant perhaps should increase it somewhat. There may be other wetlands protection zones, for instance, which don't have a buffer. Mm-hmm. In some cases, I think that might be limited, but there might be some cases where, for the same reasons or others, you might want to have a buffer. And that allows you that opportunity to exit. The planning board to examine that question.
Is it possible to talk a little bit about what is not allowed in the buffers now that people want allowed in the buffers? I mean, we've only got like another hour. To some degree, we're going to have to get down to it. What is the content? Could you just quickly summarize what's allowed in the buffers and what others have brought forward as wanting allowed?
For the most part, unless you start getting into some of the most recent changes with agriculture and timber harvesting, I think most things that are not allowed in the critical wetland zones are then not allowed in the buffer too. I think that's one concern that people have. I think a lot of people could see that it's important to protect wetlands, critical wetlands, but in the buffer zone, they may question whether or not there's a need to have the same level of protection that you know, in the buffer that would exist for the natural resource itself.
Phyllis, go ahead. I think you had something.
I was going to make some comment to Marion about helping to interpret. In our ordinance and also in the new pending state ordinance, there is a range of 75 feet where nothing can be done. It has to be kept natural from the wetlands. And that would be one of your criteria that you would use for judging. But the other question I wanted was also the idea that Steve was saying about now when we say critical wetlands and what can and can't be done is that the buffer is being treated with equal weight as the actual wetland site itself, and that perhaps should be clarified a little better. And another question I had is I wanted to ask Peter or Steve or someone, if we did reclassify things according to the class 1, 2, and 3, how complicated would that be as far as the wetlands? Did you get the new?
No, I didn't.
I was going to ask him that a minute ago.
This is the revised State of Maine Department of Environmental Protection draft on the 12th of December. And it does, it defines them. That'd be helpful.
We'll get you a copy, Peter, so then I think it'd be wise to look it over and see what you...
Again, not being a wetlands expert, but knowing something about wetlands after a number of years. I think that what class one and two, and I said this at the ordinance committee meeting, and my views haven't changed all that much. Class one and two, I think, would definitely fall into the definition of critical wetland. I think the main difference is that class one is, I think, primarily or solely marine wetlands. The class two are freshwater wetlands of a certain type. And then class three is kind of the type of wetland where you might start to draw a dotted dashed line in terms of separation. And those, for the most part, include wet meadows and something else.
Wooded swamps.
And I think the wet meadows would, in most cases, fall under what we would consider to be wetland protection zones, the yellow on the map, you know, kind of the lesser sort of areas to be protected. The big question, the swing boat, so to speak, would be the wooded swamps. And I'm not, you know, in some cases, you know, some might fall into wetlands protection zone, and others, in fact, most of them, I think, might fall into what we consider to be a critical wetland. Yeah. right now, under the current ordinance as well as the proposed, I think most of the wooded wetlands would probably trigger critical wetlands review and the limitations. The state, I think, for various reasons, might bump into class three where there's more room for negotiation. So going to class two or three might, I'm not sure how much it's going to buy you. It might be worthwhile, but I'm not sure that there's complete agreement on classification. And I think that this throws another political issue in terms of how to deal with wooded swamps. That's a tough one.
Okay. Something else? Yes, Janet.
Something totally new that we haven't touched on yet today. In section 18.4.7 under road construction.
What page is that exactly?
Can you define for me what would be involved under reconstruction of an existing road?
In terms of what that would include.
What would that include?
I think it would be if you had a public roadway that was there now and that it needed to be widened or it just needed to be built up, and to do that you might have to extend either the side slopes or actually even the pavement itself, travel away into what would consider to be a critical wetland. But that could be done. I suppose even to the point if you were thinking along main turnpike sort of thoughts, you know, if you wanted to, if there's some roads in the town, heaven forbid, that would, you know, need to have an extra lane or two.
How would this relate to what we've been discussing at the council level of the shoulder improvements on Shore Road?
I think under this, they would be allowed. But as going through the special, I believe the special permit process, but with the extra requirements being that as much as possible, you want to do the improvements, the shoulders, what have you, in a way that would minimize the impacts on the wetlands. And if there's some way you can do it to avoid it, then you should. And if you can't, then you should take steps to make sure the impacts on whatever that might entail. That's why those extra requirements are there, is to, if you meet all the other tests, there's an extra standard in terms of trying to get what the new state regulations do get into, which is kind of mitigation or kind of minimization of what was impact. There are some uses that maybe are going to impact critical wetlands, and there's a public benefit, the public benefit outweighs of that improvement outweighs the disadvantage of the wetlands loss, but within that perspective, you do wouldn't want to go hog wild, wouldn't want to allow blatant critical wetlands destruction after that would happen to Elizabeth. But it could be done. I mean, that's why those extra steps are there.
It could be done. The town would have to go through the special permit process before the planning board in order to do that project.
And that's the same for a private road, and how about a private driveway? They'd have to go through the same process on a...
Not a driveway, but suppose if there was an existing private road.
What's the definition between a driveway and a private road? If I had a driveway of my own, would it be a private road, or would it be a driveway?
Get out the dictionary. I think that's defined. So I think the language says the customer use.
I think the home would be a driveway.
Okay.
Does it, if it's served.
What do you choose?
Single home, you think it would be a driveway.
One or two, it could be a driveway, yeah.
Nancy.
Steve, you mentioned mitigation. At any point along the line in the designing of this wonderful ordinance, now in draft number 21 form, did you consider mitigation as the state regs?
We considered it, not quite to the extent that the new regs have come up with, but it's on page 16, 18-4-13, Wetlands Restoration and Creation. And that the thought was that there may be some cases where, as part of the special permit process, if some wetlands do somehow get impacted or affected, that there may be other, that it might be necessary to create new wetlands or improve.
Restore.
Restore substandard wetlands. That's one thing that I think the state regs, from the Natural Resources Protection Act, I think they do a pretty good job of getting into that in great detail. They talk about the different ratios in terms of if you're going to create new wetlands, the ratios, you know, if it's a high-value wetland, you're going to have to create more wetlands than if it's a low value. And I think creation is treated differently than restoration existing. So I mean, they go into a lot of detail into that. So we have it here. But we touch upon it, we don't go into it in full bore in the same degree as the state. And I think part of that may be philosophical in that the state, when you read those regs, they almost assume that there's going to be a fair amount of wetlands lost, which is going to require mitigation. And I think when this is being developed, the thought was that hopefully, in the majority of cases, that's not going to happen, that you're going to have either no impact or minimal impact. So I think the hope may be that that section never has to be used or is used very seldom.
A couple of the letters referred to criticism of the fact that if land has been filled in, that I guess this ordinance still applies to it as if it were wetland, even though now, albeit done at midnight or whatever, it's no longer wetland. What's your response to that?
The response is...
Oh, what was the... Not your editorial opinion.
Yeah, no.
Why was
that?
Okay.
That was your chance.
I that was too wide an
open. I mean, still
what was the reasoning behind that, Steve?
Okay. The reasoning behind it, I think, was that there have been at least one or two instances that the planning board knows of, and I think the council as well, where there had been some filling at some point. It was unclear when that had happened. And there's a basic, again, I think a philosophical public policy perspective that if filling had been done on a critical wetland, that the fact that the filling occurred by whomever shouldn't obscure the fact that there was at one point a wetland there. Therefore, if somebody owned property that hadn't filled, that didn't automatically entitle them to do something because of that filling. So it's in some specifics we get into if you had to, but that's a relatively recent change that was proposed. I'm not even sure if it was done ordinance at the town council ordinance committee level, or if it was done as the planning board and the conservation commission met for the final time for recommending the approval. That's in response to some a couple of specific cases.
You have a page.
What page is this? No, I don't have it.
Yes, ma'am.
Steve, during the public hearing the last time, a young gentleman came forward and had purchased one lot, and it was rather sad. He was afraid he wouldn't be able to develop that one lot for his wife's savings. Are there any changes here to address the situation? Is that 1984 supposed to address that?
I'm sorry, which section are you
in? There's a section about the
grandfathering.
I don't know. Does that address the situation that happened?
Partially, but I don't think it is. It hasn't been changed all that much, I don't think, since the public hearing. I think the questions still exist. I think part of this gets maybe back to Wayne's comment about the buffer and the whole question of the buffer, the extent of it, and all the rest. It sounded like the cases like that came up primarily with people who own land, people who didn't want to put a house right in the middle of a critical wetland, but the people that own land within the 250-foot buffer. But I'm not sure that what's here now would adequately address and solve that person's problem. If it's part of a subdivision, at a certain point, the language gets a little technical. But if you're within a subdivision that was created after a certain date, you have, I think it's 10 years to do something. And then after that, forget it. Now, I think there's one example where the lot was in the subdivision that was created before December 13th, 1984. So that person,
I'm not sure how that would...
What would happen if he, would he happen to be able to go before the planning board, his lot being rendered totally undevelopable?
I don't know the specifics, but I think the question would either be to question whether or not it was, if the wetlands boundaries were different, he could do that. But if it's, if it truly was in the buffer as it stands right now, and if he didn't have anything, if it's just an undeveloped lot, it looks as though he wouldn't be able to build a lot.
I thought we, in changing some of the activity in buffers in our last meeting, made it possible for someone to build or expand into one of the buffers, but then we had that breaking point of 75 feet where nothing could happen. Didn't
just
we
one,
lessen
one,
that
one,
somewhere?
One,
it seemed to me that we lessened
just
it.
That was done. Alterations, nothing about new construction.
I think one of the people that, one of the, I wasn't at public hearing, I think one of the people at the hearing was concerned about addition.
Mm-hmm.
So this
right.
may have been changed to address that, but in terms of somebody just bought a lot for investments
yeah.
down the road, I don't think that's going to change to address that.
Is there anything that we could do to address that? Because this person might not be alone.
This is appeal. Last page. It's very
quick. No.
Well, you can also change. You can also change the date. I mean, we had considered using the implementation of the current active comprehensive plan, which would have pushed things back to 1980. What we tried to do, by the way, I mean, was not in any sense of the word, to look upon a particular development as either before or after that 12/13/84 date. We tried very hard in balancing a given date to go as back as far as we could to involve as so that as few as possible subdivisions, and we looked about the Hobstone one, and I think we didn't appreciate the fact that I guess parts of Cranbrook would be problematic with that particular date when we first looked at that, Nancy, as I recall us trying to think off the top of our heads as to what subdivisions would or would not be included.
You want to add something to that? Go ahead.
I thought we had asked Steve or to ask the code enforcement officer to verify another date. We were going to revisit that date.
Yes, that's right.
Grandfathering date.
That's right.
We don't have the information.
This is not that date right now.
This is not a revisited date. This has been the same date.
We have not revisited that date.
That's right.
Nancy.
Might another alternative be some sort of hardship procedure or even a special permit procedure where a person in a situation like that might make an exception?
There's several ways you could go about changing that.
I know it's very hard to prove hardship, but
you could
that's
for
obvious how hard.
Oh, it was.
In the buffer, just number of possibilities. One would be you can change the buffer itself. As you know, you can do. You could, for residential construction or other types of construction, you could allow a special permit to be done within the buffer. You could allow certain uses to be done a certain distance away from the critical edge, like what was suggested in terms of agriculture. You know, that within 75 feet of the critical wetland. For new agriculture, you can't do anything, but beyond that, you could. You know, there's a number of ways you could try and address the issue in terms of the buffer itself.
I think it should only be for individual lot owners.
Not a development.
Nothing new. Well, but I mean, I think it was Mr. Rumery who had a couple of, or several, I mean, three versus one versus two, but I mean, we're getting into, again, I think specific examples.
Are all these lots strictly in the buffer, though, or any of them in the resource protection zone?
That I don't know.
I mean, because if you give in the buffer, do you give in a little in the resource protection zone, too, then?
We haven't checked it.
I don't know.
I mean, we can check in terms of lots. I think the two that I remember or have heard of secondhand would be one, I think the Cranbrook example primarily was in the buffer. I think the other example, I'm not sure. I mean, I think right now it might fall, some of the lot might actually.
I just think we have to tread very carefully as a precedent setting.
Anybody else? I got a couple of things I'd like to throw out, a little bit different than what we've been discussing, so you're pretty well caught up with what.
And another ordinance, you mean?
No, not on the same ordinance, but it's kind of.
How different, sorry.
Yeah, it's kind of in the field of the minorities as far as numbers go, okay?
Okay.
You get that?
I get you.
You're not talking postage stamps?
No, I'm not talking postage stamps. But the numbers are there as a minority, but the acreage might be a little bit the other way. One is ponds, individual ponds around somebody has around their homes there. Now, we got it in here, 1,000 square feet, you know, that's a pretty small pond, in my opinion. What is it, 10 by 100?
Like a 50.
Huh? They're very large, a lot of them, and some have been around here for a good number of years. And I don't see why, if somebody's had a pond for a good number of years, why they can't maintain that pond and continue to the upkeep on it. Now it's considered a wetlands, and you better not, all you can do is let your ducks and geese go in them, and that's it. Can't touch them, clean them up, or nothing. And I don't think that should be the way that we want things in this town. It isn't the way I like to see it, anyway. I think they should be maintained and kept up. If you're doing for 1,000 square feet, you ought to be able to do one for a quarter of an acre. And that isn't a very big pond, a quarter of an acre.
Dam should be reconstructed.
That's right. Dam should be. So.
What is a normal size irrigation pond in this town?
Well, they vary. I know one that's 5 acres, and I know one that's a little over an acre.
5 acres?
Yeah.
Is it totally owned by one person?
Yeah.
That was something we discussed about having, if it was within one person's, not one individual owner's property, that it could be maintained. But there also are other areas in town that are groomed and maintained that would fall into these wetland zones or these buffer zones that have been done for generations that should also be exempted or grandfathered and continue to be able to be maintained too. I don't know how we word it.
Well, I don't either. I mean, I think it's something we should look at. So.
How big is your pond?
Well, one of them I said is about 5 acres in it. The other one is only about an acre.
The one on Wellstone?
That's only about an acre, so.
That's
big.
How big is Mr. Carter's?
Only be, well, it goes back there quite a ways. I would say half an acre.
And he's maintained that.
Yeah. What was other people doing? I know a guy right next to me, as I mentioned at our next committee meeting, is what they call the duck pond ever since I've been around here, and I think it was when the place was purchased, 1700 or 1800. And they have a little house out in the middle of it where the ducks go in, the geese and what have you. Now, according to this, it's larger than 1,000 square feet. He can't maintain it. As I understand it.
If it's not being used for agriculture.
It's not being used for agriculture.
Raising ducks is considered agriculture.
Well, it's a hobby to them.
Yeah. Is how expensive would it be to document the existing ponds and have them all grandfathered?
The existing individual ones?
Individual ponds that are the irrigation ponds and the ornamental ponds. It is. And not all of those are owned by one property owner, but.
Peter, there seems to be some disagreement about that position since the public hearing, at least Mr. Clough indicated the pond was on his house, on the top of his roof, as he looked at.
We were talking about identifying the
pond. Identifying.
Okay, so just adding them up then, but we still got to figure out where they are in terms of the square footage of them.
Well, why can't we do it generically? That would be too much work.
Well, I think something might be done.
Why can't we just define them as ponds?
Because technically they're considered wetlands now, you can't do anything. We're trying to exempt them.
Well, I think, yes, most anybody has a pond, they have a use for it. I mean, they either ice skate in the winter and things like that.
The one thing you just, in terms of defining it or identifying them or what have you, one thing you just want to be careful of and make sure you deal with this issue that you could have somebody calling it a pond and they're doing a tremendous amount of wetlands alteration. That's as long as there was true wetland, true ponds that existed and maintenance, not expansion, whatever else, then I think we might do something. It would be difficult to define that. But again, with a lot of things here, what appears on the surface to be burdensome are there to make sure somebody doesn't, to make sure the town doesn't inadvertently create a loophole that somebody can walk right through. But I agree that in terms of trying to preserve existing ponds, maintain them, that may be a legitimate.
What do we mean by maintain? There are some people who would probably like to uproot all the cattails.
That's right. That's right. You don't want them going in there because they'll take over the pond in a certain number of years. I feel something ought to be done. They shouldn't be illegal just because they go out there and pull up a cat nine tail to keep the pond maintained, which they do.
We don't have
any more swimming holes.
We used to have them down in Spurg Marsh years ago in the river.
We have a pond at the fort that's being overgrown by cattails, and we certainly would hate to see
That's a municipal pond. They're allowed to do different things.
That's a municipal skating pond.
Yeah. I wonder how
do
that
we
could
skate work. On that pond?
Yes.
Yes.
Mike does.
Okay, so that one does qualify. But if we didn't skate on it, it wouldn't fall under this ordinance.
Council Chair, on a yearly basis, shall skate that pond.
If you are interested in taking care of...
I got a pair of skates.
And if you are interested in taking care of the current ponds, we could go through a very easy process of identifying them and also go through a system of a registration. Put it in the newsletter that register by a certain date and it would be grandfathered according to whatever standard you come up with. So it could be relatively, it could be done relatively easily with the documentation in the clerk's office as to what ponds we're talking about.
Okay.
Let's do it.
Let's.
I'll sit on that one. Now the other one is, and maybe some of the experts here can tell me, why was agriculture grandfathered in this one? I'd like to know. Why is agriculture grandfathered?
Well, I didn't expect that. I think agriculture is grandfathered because it was felt that, as you've shown again and again, that farming is important to the town, that the town is trying to take as many steps as possible to try and preserve what's left, and the town trying to do its part. What it wanted to do, though, and so I think in terms of the grandfathering, that's why that's there. The way I would interpret the ordinance, agriculture is allowed to do, existing agriculture is allowed to do quite a few things, even within the critical wetlands themselves, relative buffer zone. What the ordinance tries to do, though, is it tries to prevent somebody from coming in and calling some wetlands alteration farming, and then 3 or 4 months later, turning around and selling the same land that's now failed or altered for residential house lots. And that's why the ordinance looks ominous to agriculture, but if you cross-reference and you go into other sections of the ordinance, you find that actually I feel that the ordinance is very lenient on farmers and kind of backs up the town's interest in preserving what farms there are. But it prevents that loophole from occurring that would hit somebody who came in and said, this is a farm doing everything that's running around and doing a subsequent non-farming activity.
Yeah, but when they have to come by doing a non-farming activity, what do you mean by that? I mean, doing a developer?
Putting a house in a filled critical wetland.
Well, he'd have to go before these other boards or what have you before he could do that. He couldn't automatically do that, put a house in there, could he?
For residential.
I don't read it that way.
New residential construction is not allowed in the critical wetland zone.
That's right.
However, farming, if you've done it before, you've done farming in a critical wetland now or sometime in the past, you'd be allowed to continue that. Somebody could, as part of farming activity, perhaps could hay the salt, you know, or you know, harvest the salt hay or what have you, maybe extend in a farm field or what you would call, he or she would call a farm field, out to a certain area, farm it even for a year or two, you know, or have it, you know, making the pasture, sell the hay so it maybe falls in the definition of agriculture, and then later on that filled land, filled pasture land, what have you, then carve it off into hut lots and then sell it and have somebody go through the...
Well, it's still going to be in a critical wetland area as far as soils or what have you, so they wouldn't be able to build anything on it, do anything with it.
Well, the question is going to be in terms of the filling aspects of it, but supposedly, if, you know, once it's there, I mean, somebody could perhaps go out. If you fill wetlands enough, you can have somebody go out there and say, nope, it's not a wetland now, it's filled land.
No, but you got that covered. We just discovered it a minute ago. We just discussed that about filled wetlands.
So the question
would be considered a wetland, regardless of whether they filled it or not.
But I think there's still a question in terms of if it was filled as part of a permitted activity, if that then that, there's a question I think in terms of whether or not that provision would come in. You know, you had wetlands that was legally filled under this ordinance, and somebody came in and something else. I think it's something, you know, if,
you feel, oh, go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, there's other people out there feel that that the town has kind of felt that they weren't good people, so they made their operation non-conforming in this town, which has been conforming since the Cape was created. That's what the feeling is out there.
Can I just respond to that? Because I didn't respond the evening of the first public hearing, and Steve didn't give his explanation that night either, and I think that that whole issue became a very charged emotional issue needlessly. I don't think it was ever our intent in the ordinance to imply in any sense of the word that farmers were not wanted, they were not allowed, that we didn't want them here, or that the whole process of farming and agriculture was being grandfathered. That was not our intent. If anything, what we were trying to do with this ordinance was to say, look, we're just going to leave everything alone that farmers are doing right now, or at least as of the implementation of the ordinance, period, and that any new agricultural activities in the future, when they abutted or involved wetlands or critical wetland zones, we were trying to be as liberal as possible with respect to footage and buffer areas that would impinge upon those wetlands. And I think in the new section here, page 13, 18.4-10, with regard to agriculture, we're still saying there shall be no new agricultural activities in a critical wetland zone's buffer area within 75 feet. And we thought that that basically was a very generous footage with respect to new activities, but that anything that was going on, agricultural activities that existed on or prior to the passage of this ordinance, shall be governed by section 18.4-14, which is page 18B, basically, which states, agricultural activities shall be exempt from this subsection. I mean, I think we, in all honesty, went to special efforts to applaud agricultural activities. And I, unfortunately, just think it was taken the wrong way.
Well, I think it is, and I think when you want to be prepared when you're public hearing, because you're going to hear from, like I say, the minorities in numbers, one, two, or three of them.
Well, I think
the sizable landowners in the town, and I would think that they're going away with the feeling that, hey, we're going to put the clamps on you. You're in a non-conforming business.
I think that was unfortunate, but I think it was misconstrued.
Yeah, go ahead.
Just briefly, so I've talked to, I think, at least two of those people who have those feelings, and again, you know, I made the same point that Wayne mentioned, that the intent is not that at all. I think the realization is there for at least some people that, although it may initially sound negative, in actuality, the ordinance does just the opposite.
I don't think it does. I personally don't feel it does just the opposite. I mean, there's a lot of language in there, but still the outright word is agriculture is a non-conforming business in the town of Cape Elizabeth. Regardless, with all your exemptions, you can do this, that, and so. Is that correct?
Only when it applies to critical wetland zones. I mean, this is not, we're not making a statement on agriculture in America. We're only saying as it applies to critical wetland zones. I mean, okay. I think that's the difference. I don't think that's what people realized.
There's areas here and there's different areas there. What are you going to do with an individual that has a horse or two, which is a few in Cape Elizabeth, and they're grazing in a critical wetland area, but they're not agricultural people, in a sense?
That doesn't bother me. What did you want me to...
Well, why are they involved here as well as a guy that's in the business? This is my point. He ain't bothering you because he's got a couple of horses and they're grading in the critical wetland or the wetland area. That doesn't bother you because he's a gentleman and his daughter likes a horse or two. But you take over here, the guy that's in the business, he can't let his do that, can he?
I'm not sure. Can you respond to that, Steve? I'm not sure that the...
I guess I wasn't sure about the last part. What type of agricultural activity do you want to go on in a critical wetland zone?
I don't think there's any agricultural. People like to gather the hay and, you know what I mean, and things like that. And it could be considered in a critical wetland area. And the opinion of some people as far as the soils and the plants that grow there, or that fern will come up in a year or two and so on and so forth, if they don't mow it every year.
But the present farmers can keep doing it no matter what.
The present ones.
Whatever he's doing now.
No, he's not doing that now, but he might want to expand. He can't do that without a permit. Is that correct?
It's never been used before.
Well, it's been used before, but it's been laid there for 4 or 5 years.
Well, then I think it would be, then I think it would fall under the non-conforming activity section, which says that activity would be exempt. There's no time period beyond which the non-conformity, it becomes extinguished. If that person wanted to go into an area that had never been farmed before, ever, then that person would have to meet the requirements, but that would also apply to there's new sections in here that would just prevent activity for brand new agricultural activity be prevented in the critical wetland and within 75 feet. And the rest of the buffer zone, that would be allowed. That's one of the new sections that was recently.
See, I think if you use the language of non, you immediately get on the defensive and you think it's something bad. But if we didn't use that language, then we couldn't exempt agriculture in terms of this ordinance, which is why, language-wise, that was the only way we could address the issue and almost highlight it as a special exemption that we wanted to be crystal clear about. But I think that non-language is it's kind of a negative approach to say something positive, maybe.
Okay, go ahead, Steve.
Just one more. I just want to, in terms of what's agriculture and what isn't, one of the things that I did at your town, at the Ordinance Committee's request was to put in a few new definitions, one of which is on page one, agriculture. It comes out of the, I think, almost verbatim out of the draft shoreland zoning ordinance language, model ordinance language. And that, I just wanted to draw that to your attention to make sure that people agree with that definition, because it deals with the production, keeping, or maintenance for sale or lease of plants and or animals. And then it says it does not include forest management or timber harvesting activities. I want to make sure that that fits in with everybody's concept of what agriculture is.
Well, I think, you know, I did want to ask about that because we could have included there that agriculture is the production, keeping or maintenance for sale or lease of plants and or animals, including but not limited to forages and sod crops, grains and seed crops, dairy animals and dairy products, poultry and poultry products, livestock, fruits and vegetables, and ornamental and greenhouse products, if we really wanted to be totally consistent with page 27 of the shoreland zoning. But we've eliminated that and left it, in a sense, more global so that you even have, you know, more possibilities than just those specifics.
Which, again, that says not limited to, that's as global as you can get anyway.
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh.
That says but not limited to and then lists 20 things.
Just to
what about the horses?
Further amplify. It's
an animal.
But not for sale or lease, though.
Huh?
Not for sale or lease.
Oh, I see what you're saying. Okay.
Unless they give riding lessons.
Well, the new state ordinance is coming down that there will be no tilling of soil or grazing of livestock within 75 feet of the normal high water line of a water body or upland edge of a wetland. Existing uses, however, can be maintained.
But so, new uses, the horse couldn't come 75 feet.
That's right.
That is true. They got a... They, they got another one.
That's proposed state.
I had a meeting yesterday, but they canceled it due to the storm. But it's next, and it's even worse than that these people can't even graze their cattle within 75 or 100 feet from a brook, stream, pond, and the shoreline. And I don't know how far it's going on. This is what they're doing.
But this can be maintained.
In terms of what, that's why when we were looking at wetlands, wetlands, you know, have been an important issue to the town for quite a few years. So we were just taking bits and pieces of shoreline zoning. There's a lot of other battles coming on down the road when you have to, the town has to upgrade its entire, the rest of its shore, the non-wetlands aspects of its shoreline zoning provisions, because streams are going to be much more heavily regulated, just as you said, among other things.
Okay. You got...
Suggested a change or asked a question about a change in the buffers, and I really don't think that we addressed that. The individual various people, I think we feel about that.
I mean a specific suggestion to eliminate the buffers.
At this point,
I'm not in favor.
No.
Oh, we can't have you. You've got to have 75 feet anyway.
You want 75 feet?
Yeah, right.
Well, I don't get that.
Right, beyond 75 feet, unless we had special circumstances, for example, with Great Pond, that kind of special exemptions. Steve had two other possibilities. I mean, that was the most radical of the possibilities. What he had suggested, there were three possible suggestions. One was to require a special permit for residential buildings and accessory structures. Two was reduce or eliminate the wetland buffers for residential buildings and accessory structures, and then three was to completely eliminate the wetland buffer requirement for new residential construction and all uses. Those were the three areas that I thought that we could debate, this afternoon.
I'll say no to elimination, period,
right,
of all of them.
Okay.
So we'll eliminate that, and we can go on to the others.
Okay, anybody want?
The group.
What was yours? You would consider eliminating beyond 75 feet? Okay.
That's really number three, but we're qualifying it beyond 75 feet. Reduce or eliminate the wetland buffers for all uses. That's right, recognizing that there's a 75 foot.
How do we reconcile that then with the 250 feet in the shoreland, the new proposed shoreland zone?
It's simply not state law. It's only a proposal.
and it does become spoken.
But we do have.
I think it's very short-sighted, our parts, very short-sighted.
Right.
To come back and change this ordinance after all that we see what direction this is going in. It's going in more protection, not less protection.
But I think what we're saying is we're trying to preempt the state by pushing a 250 story when we could, for the moment, push a 75. And if it's state law, I mean, then all we do during periodic amendments, as we do with all of the ordinances, is we change 75 to 250. It isn't that complicated.
I just keep getting the feeling that these numbers are getting picked out of a hat, like they're interchangeable. There's research that's gone behind the 250 number. I'm sure there's reams of research. I'd like to have access to that. Why was that a determinant factor? If you're going to have a house 75 feet, to me, doesn't seem like enough of a buffer to protect the wetland from all the activity that goes on at a house. 250 feet on the surface to a layman seems to make much more sense. So I just want us to stop interchanging these numbers like they were variables thrown at a dartboard. They were conducted and got about by research. And I would like to see be maybe exposed to some of that research as to why. Why was that number chosen?
That brings a point, Frank, in that there ought to be standards for why one has buffers to for instance, the slope of the land that's coming out of the water. You have a steep slope. It's a different reason for a buffer than that. Have a long gradual slope. Mm-hmm. And just following that on one more step, you mentioned earlier about having all the wetlands mapped, or perhaps an idea would be to have the buffers in fact mapped, and then we have to put on specific criteria rather than a blanket 250 feet from the
You mean from the upland edge?
From the critical wetland edge back.
I like that idea, because I'm amenable. I don't like the blanket 75, I guess, and I don't like the blanket 250. And maybe we do have to be a little bit more particular, and different buffers have different criteria such that I'm amenable to that, definitely.
I think we do have to be a lot more realistic about the existence and the value of the buffer and what part of it is really valuable. And I think that's one thing the state has done that makes a lot of sense, mm-hmm. is to give the different criteria based on slope and whatever else there is. And I have had some experience with a project in another town where that criteria was used, and it seemed to me at that time to be a very sensible way to approach the kind of buffer that we had around, that was going to be required around an existing pond.
See, I wish that somehow we could get a clear feel as to, as everyone suggests, you know, how did the state come up with these magic numbers? I mean, because obviously a 250-foot buffer, I'll pick a more rural county like Aroostook, is not going to affect perhaps as much building as it would in Cumberland. And I would be very interested to find who and what criteria was used with the state people to come up with these particular numbers that we do have, because I'm not clear about where that was gauged. I mean, communities like Cape Elizabeth, I mean, that have a greater density of individuals per square acre is going to, I think, greatly affect potentially more people than a less populated county.
Is there any way of getting at any of the research that went behind that?
I think it's pretty sketchy. I can try and find some. But there, I know when this was first being discussed way back, it was the big issue. From people first time on growth management 4 or 5 years ago. And back then they were using 330 feet. And it's somehow it and whittle down to 250 feet. There may be scientific reasons, and maybe other reasons.
I think that the common sense was about to come into the whole picture of it, and I would be very much in favor of something that was much more flexible, less rigid than just picking the number. That makes common sense.
I don't want us to lose track of what we accomplished in our last ordinance committee meeting. Originally, the 250-foot buffer and the 100 buffer did not allow timber harvesting. It didn't allow a lot of activities, including many agricultural activities. And that has all been changed. If you go through and compare this draft with the previous draft, that there are certain things that are now allowed or allowed with special permit that were not allowed before. So essentially, we have made them much more flexible.
You have.
And the idea of just completely eliminating them is wrong.
Right, I agree.
Maybe the 250 foot is still bigger than it needs to be, but I really would not want to reduce certain activities in that range until we can find out why it was 250 feet.
Right, I agree.
Mm-hmm. But they're not as stringent as they were. They're much more flexible, much more realistic already.
Access still extremely restricted as far as residential.
There has to
Just a minute.
Just on the issue of the research for how much the critical edge ought to be, it all depends on if the source of the research is the Natural Resources Council of Maine or the Maine Home Builders Association. And there's a whole body of research out there, and that's exactly the issue if you've been following it in the Maine Times and otherwise. It's exactly the issue the state is going through now, is they're getting the pull from either direction. And what it based, and you know, remind you of when you were looking at Rachel Carson in the Spermic Marsh, they very much wanted a critical edge, and it was all over the place as to the footage. And what it really comes down to is it's a policy judgment on how much you really want to protect. And there's research out there to convince whatever point you'd like to come down.
Well, not if we have Peter's state arbitrator. Who
Okay.
You know,
okay.
You don't know my opinion of the state's
He's also a conservation man of Scarborough, according to a letter that I got from the state. Is that right, Peter?
Sure.
Because we looked at a wetland area that they had in my place down there. When they walked over a little bit, they said, no, I guess it isn't. Right?
Yeah, and it's an example of the problem that the upper areas you're talking about, the state wants to put around state-defined 10-acre DEP wetlands. We have shown the state that where they've met those wetlands in Cape Elizabeth are grossly in error. You talk about people being concerned about where we put the wetlands, where the state put the wetlands, in some places are absolutely ludicrous. And as Billy said, right in the middle of this field, we have an island. And so, as I understand the situation now, is that we can, that when we put critical wetlands, the state will accept those critical wetlands. By that same token, I think we can put up buffer areas, pretty much where we want to put up buffer areas, and not go by 250 feet or whatever.
Steve, go ahead.
Just so it's clear in everybody's mind, again, maybe making a big assumption that this stays the way it is, that for the most part, what Peter and I did, this is actually Peter's map, is state's map, but here's the most immediate source, is in yellow are the wetlands that would have either a moderate or a high wildlife habitat value. And that's the W3, Great Pond obviously is high value, W2 is moderate. And so you can see the wetlands at a minimum, it would appear as though the state is going to require the 250-foot buffer. Great Pond in and of itself, you know, that that's covered now, and but the others I think would be added.
This example would make that Department of Fisheries and Wildlife. They got about as far north as here, actually, starting from down in North County 2 years ago. They met all the wildlife areas in each of the towns. This is their map of Cape Elizabeth, and they find their relative priorities.
This is a very conservative interpretation because theoretically, what the state has said that all W5, which W5 is indeterminate, they don't know. They probably haven't gone out and checked. What they've recommended to some communities is that anything that's W5 should be thrown in. If you want to err on the side of safety in terms of wetlands protection, you should probably throw those in. We didn't mark those, but there's several that perhaps be put in. We all around here. We also didn't flag those wetlands that are probably going to be covered under the stream alteration changes and other aspects of shoreline zoning. So this is going to expand. But if this is kind of a pretty good idea in terms of the major wetlands that are going to be covered at a minimum once you're required to deal with shoreline zoning. So there's some obvious ones, as I said, Spermic Marsh, Great Pond, Little Pond, maybe some less obvious ones. And so I had a call Bill before I had a copy of this to see where Richard's Pond is.
You want me to tell you what happened to that?
By the good state.
Part of it? State filled it in when they made the parking lot down the state park.
Oh.
That is just W, the state, without a number.
That's us. Didn't even see that, W1. It goes down.
They didn't fill it all in, most of it.
Well, you know, what happened in that area.
That's true.
Okay, anybody else, anything they'd like to add to it? We've been here approximately 2 hours at it, and I think that was what we intended to do. And somebody got a comment or something they'd like to add?
Well, I think
we've answered some of the questions that some of the people is available to watch, and maybe the agricultural question might not come up, but I think it might come up. That's one reason it was thrown out. So you got something you'd like to add?
I certainly think we've dealt with and at least discussed the major areas of criticism. I think I've heard at least some marching orders with respect to going back to the ordinance committee with my fellow councilors, and again trying to fine-tune this further in the hopes of getting it close enough for a March town council meeting to complete the public hearing process, and then we can take it from there. It would be absolutely impossible, though, I think, to get the appropriate work done the right way on this ordinance to have it on board for the February town council meeting. And I apologize to the citizens who want and would very much prefer the second public hearing to be at that meeting, but I think to do it the appropriate way, we really need that time.
Anybody else got anything they'd like to add?
I think this was absolutely critical for me. These 2 hours were so informative. I just want to thank Steve and Peter and Mary for coming and adding so much to my understanding of this.
I also want to thank everybody that came, also Mary and Peter and Steve especially, for taking their time off to join the council in the workshop. And I shall repeat again, in case somebody turned in late, that this will be rebroadcast tonight at 7:30 p.m. on February 6th at 12 noon and 4 p.m. and at 7:30 p.m. on the 6th of February. And I guess that's it. If it is, good night. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Is this work?